Matthew chapter 5, and today we're going to begin an 8-week study on the Beatitudes of Jesus. We're going to learn in these Beatitudes how to live like Jesus lived, because Jesus practiced what he taught. And he's teaching us in the Beatitudes how we ought to live, and it's the way he lived. And let's start today by looking at the first three verses in this fifth chapter, thinking about a new kind of living. Let's stand together to honor God and to thank him for his word. And seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Look at that now. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Well, if you can be blessed by being poor in spirit, don't you want to know what that means? To be poor in spirit so you can be blessed? Jesus said, "For theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Lord, may the Holy Spirit of God teach us this morning. Take your word and engraft it and implant it into our hearts, that we might be poor in spirit, that we might bring glory and honor to your name. In the name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated and keep your Bibles open with you. Look at how Jesus begins his teaching. Blessed. That word literally means happy. Blessed or happy. Jesus is saying, happy are the poor in spirit. Now, it's a wonderful thing to be happy. And you can go to the bookstore today and find all kinds of books about how to be happy. But you only need to read this. You only need to read God's word. Because Jesus said, happy, blessed, happy are the poor in spirit. In other words, happiness, according to Jesus, is based on this kind of living that he teaches us in the Beatitudes. The majority of people in this world are not happy, and that's because they're not poor in spirit. You see, living poor in spirit begins with humility, and there's not a lot of humility in the world today. Jesus is talking here about selfless living. He's saying that before we can be full of Jesus, we have to be empty of self. If you understand that, say amen. And so he's talking about happiness is for the humble. The Bible tells us that God gives grace to the humble. But what does it mean to be poor in spirit? I want you to look at that word poor in your Bible and circle that word, because it's rich with meaning. In the New Testament, there's a word used for poor that is a very common word, but this particular word, poor, is not the common word for poor that is used in the New Testament. Jesus uses a much stronger word here. This word means to be destitute. It means to be helpless. It means to be hopeless. It means to be powerless. In fact, in the New Testament, the beggars would cower down in a corner, and they would hold one hand out, and they would put the other hand in front of their face like this to hide their face, because they were ashamed that they were begging, and they didn't want anybody to see who they were, so they would try to hide their face. And that's the word that Jesus used. Jesus said, happy are the poor in spirit. Happy are those who are cringing. Now think about this, who are cowering before God, who have their hand up in front of their face. They're ashamed to look at God, and they're holding this hand out because they know they need something, and they're helpless. They're totally destitute. They are poor. And he's not talking here about being physically poor. He's talking about being poor in spirit. The word spirit comes from the word pneuma. It's the word from which we get our word pneumonia. It means breath. It's referring to the spirit of man. Blessed or happy are the poor, the destitute, the hopeless in spirit, those who have no hope in spiritual things. Why are the people like that happy? Because people who are poor in spirit recognize that God is the only hope they have spiritually. You see, when we put our pride away and we stand before God and we recognize that there's not anything that any of us can do to save ourselves, we're all spiritual beggars. And without God, we have no hope. Without God, we have no help. So this first beatitude teaches about humility, because it's the foundation. Humility is the foundation of everything else. Until a soul is humbled, Jesus can never become dear to that soul, because that soul is always obscured by self. Until one knows how spiritually helpless and sinful we are in our flesh, we can never see how mighty and worthy Jesus Christ is in himself. So how then do we become poor in spirit? Well, it can't start with us, because there's not anything in us that can accomplish this in our own power. Nor does it involve putting ourselves down. Some people have the idea that humility is putting ourselves down, but we don't have to put ourselves down when it comes to being poor in spirit, because we're already down. We're already poor in spirit. And so it simply means recognizing this truth, and simply being hopeless and helpless, obviously, is no virtue. It's not God's will for us. And Jesus said, happy are the poor in spirit. Happy are those who understand that they are spiritually destitute and hopeless without God, and who stand before God like this with a handout hiding their face, acknowledging that Christ is their only hope. To be poor in spirit means we humble ourselves and we depend upon God. And that's the way Jesus lived, if you stop and think about it. Jesus humbled himself and he placed his trust in his heavenly Father. And he says, if we want to be genuinely happy, if we want to be blessed, this is the way we have to live. We have to live our life depending upon God and not upon self. So how do we do it? It's not an easy thing to do. How do we do it? Let me share with you some things the Bible teaches. Number one, do what God says. The poor in spirit will do what God says. You see, God is all-knowing. God is all-wise. God knows so much more than we know. And when we do what God says, it will always lead to blessing. It will always lead to happiness, because God has our best interest at heart. God loves us more than we love us. God loves us more than we can imagine. And when we do what God says, then we can really know genuine happiness. I want you to turn for a moment back to the Old Testament book of Proverbs, to chapter 14. Proverbs 14. I love the book of Proverbs because it gives us such good advice and good counsel for daily living. And look at this verse. It will be familiar to many of you. In Proverbs 14, verse 12. I want you to mark this in your Bible if you haven't already. It very simply says, there is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to what? Death, right? There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. Circle the word seems in that verse. There is a way that seems right to us, to human beings, but the end of that is death. It's a dead end. Have you ever had a feeling that something was the right thing to do, and you didn't pray about it? You didn't take time to pray about it. You just went ahead and did it because you just had a feeling that it was the right thing to do. And it was one of the worst decisions you ever made in your life. Have you ever had that experience? All of us have had a feeling about something, and more than likely went ahead and did it, and it turned out to be a flop. It may be a feeling about a job or you thought would be a perfect job and it was not, or maybe a relationship, or maybe a financial investment, or maybe something in parenting. And in every area of our life, we have these feelings. Anytime that we go on feelings without consulting God, we're headed for trouble. Now, I want to say that again. I want you to say amen. Anytime we go on feelings without consulting God, we're headed for trouble. Amen. I mean, it's good common sense. There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. Now, keep this in mind. How do we get God's wisdom? If we're going to do what God says, then we're going to have to understand what He says. And there are two ways that we get God's wisdom. We pray and we read His Word. When we pray and we read His Word, we get God's wisdom. Because what we're doing there is just communicating with God. When we pray, we're talking to God. When we read His Word, He's talking to us. And that means if we're not in the Word of God consistently, that we're not going to obey Him consistently. If we're not praying consistently, we're not going to obey Him consistently because we won't know what His will is. And if we don't know what His will is, then we're going to live by feelings. And we need to talk to God and let God talk to us. Happy are the poor in spirit. Do what God says. Number two, if we're going to be happy, if we're going to be poor in spirit, then we have to depend on God's strength. Depend on God's strength. That's important because our strength is so limited as human beings, but God's strength is unlimited. And that's the reason the Spirit of God led the Apostle Paul to write to the church at Philippi, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." We need to depend upon the strength of God and not our own. But for many of us, that's a new way of living. That's a new kind of living. Why? It's because we have an independent nature. We want to do things on our own, and we want to do things our own way. But what happens when all of a sudden we find ourselves in the situation where we've done our very best and our strength is gone? What happens when we're just out of steam and we don't have the strength to face what we're going through? Because every one of us knows today life gets tough. Loved ones die. Friends turn their back and walk away. Divorce happens. Job loss. Our health begins to fail. And all of these things just come almost unexpectedly out of nowhere. And what are we to do? When the world falls out from under our feet, what do? We try to suck it up and we try to take it. But the truth is, there are times when we simply do not have enough strength. And living like Jesus means we learn to depend upon God's strength. If you understand that, say amen. Listen to Isaiah 40, 31. "Those who trust in the Lord for help will find their strength renewed. They will rise on wings like eagles. They will run and not get weary. They will walk and not grow weak." In nearly 40 years of being a pastor, I have seen people go through some of the toughest situations human beings can face in life. And there's something I've observed. In the darkest moments of life, when we cannot see our way forward, God will give us His strength. He will, if we depend on Him. And the reason most people do not get through is simply because instead of depending upon God's strength, they depend upon their own. and it's just not going to work. I've seen people go through a divorce or a major illness or lose a job or lose a family member, and they never recover because they just won't let go and let God have it, depending on God's strength. There's a verse here I want you to look at. Turn with me to the book of Psalms. Psalms is a wonderful book. Chapter 71. Psalm 71. This is a good verse to put on your refrigerator or in your car so that you can look at it often. Psalm 71, verse 16. I will go in the strength of the Lord. The word go means walk. I will walk in the strength of the Lord. Now, I want to encourage you to write that verse down. Memorize it. I will go in the strength of the Lord. And say that throughout the day. I will go, I will walk in the strength of the Lord. And what a wonderful verse. If you're going through the storm, when the storm enters your mind and you're focused on the storm, just say this verse. I will walk in the strength of the Lord. Say it with me. I will walk in the strength of the Lord. Turn around and say it to somebody. I will walk in the strength of the Lord. In the 19th century, there was a missionary to China named Hudson Taylor, and he grew old and he lost his health and he became very frail. He wrote a letter to a friend that said, and I quote, "I am so weak I can no longer work. I am so weak I can no longer study. I am so weak I can no longer read my Bible. I cannot even pray. I can only lie still in the arms of God like a little child in trust," end quote. Lie still in the arms of God. What more do we need than that? There will be times in life when we're going to be so weak we can no longer go to church and no longer read the Bible, maybe no longer even pray. So what do? We walk in the strength of the Lord. We depend upon God's strength. Number three, happy are the poor in spirit. The third thing is to wait on God's timing. Wait on God's timing. Learning to live like Jesus means being poor in spirit. Being poor in spirit means that we humble ourselves, we obey God, we depend on God's strength, and we wait on God's timing. Jesus always lived like that. He always waited on the Father's timing. Do you remember the story in the Bible about the death of Lazarus? Jesus waited, and Lazarus died. Now, it seemed to Mary and Martha that Jesus did not care, but Jesus trusted his heavenly Father's timing. And after Lazarus had died, he raised him from the dead. Don't you think that made more of an impact than just getting better, being raised from the dead? You see, God's timing is always perfect. The older I get, the more I understand how timing is important in every area of life. You see, the Bible teaches there are seasons in our life. King Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, or he started out that way, didn't end up that way. But he said, to everything there is a season. And as we move through these seasons of life, we're going to spend a lot of time waiting. But while we're waiting, God is at work. In fact, God often is doing his best work while we're waiting. You see, God is never in a hurry. God is eternal. He has forever. And even though we cannot see what God is doing, it does not mean that God is not doing something. God is working while we are waiting. And so we wait on God's timing. We're going to spend a lot of time waiting. Have you ever been in a hurry when God was not? Now that'll get you in trouble. We live in a culture that wants everything now. We don't want to wait. We don't want to wait to be part of God's plan. But that's how God worked in sending Jesus into this world. The Bible tells us that the world waited for Jesus to come in the fullness of time at God's perfect time, at just the right time. We've been waiting now more than 2,000 years for him to come back. God is working. You think he's not coming? He's coming again. He's coming, but he's coming at God's perfect time. A lot of times we think while we're waiting, nothing is happening, but God is working. Let me share something else I hope you will remember. God always gives his best to those who wait. He really does. God gives his best to those who wait. If we get in a hurry, we're going to settle for second best. Before God brings the best person into our life, the best job into our life, the best opportunity into our life, the devil is going to put up all kind of roadblocks, all kind of obstacles, all kind of detours, and God's going to use those obstacles as we maneuver forward to strengthen us and grow us so that when we get there, we're ready for what is there. And God knew it all the time. So wait for God's best. If you get frantic and anxious and get in a hurry and start trying to answer your own prayer, you'll make a terrible mess. I've done it plenty of times. And you will. That's exactly what happened to Abraham. God promised Abraham he was going to give him a son. A long time went by and it didn't happen. So Sarah was barren and Abraham took her servant girl and got her pregnant and she had a boy named Ishmael. But God said to Abraham, that's not the son I was going to give to you. That's your plan. That's not my plan. That's your plan. And if we want God's best, we have to be poor in spirit. We cannot depend upon ourselves. We depend upon God's wisdom and what he says, and God's strength and God's timing. Here's the last one, number four. Trust God in all things. Trust God in all things. If we put our security in a bank account, we are insecure because we can lose everything we've got in that bank account. If we put our security in our job, we are insecure because we can lose our job. If we put our security in something that can be taken away from us, that's a foolish thing to do. But if we put our security in Christ and Christ alone, that's a very wise thing to do. Living poor in spirit means that God is the source of our supply and we trust God in all things. The question is this, ladies and gentlemen, are we really going to trust him? We want to, but are we going to? God can handle it. God will handle it. Has God not handled it before in your life? Amen. And God will handle it again. Our source and our supply is God, but we must trust him in all things. So what is the first step we need to take in becoming poor in spirit? The very first thing we need to do is make a public declaration of our faith in Jesus Christ. That's first. Will you do that today? Will you acknowledge today before this body of believers that you are trusting Jesus Christ to forgive your sin and to give you a home in heaven, and you put your faith in him today and forever and ever, because if you will, he'll save you. He'll save you. 2 weeks ago, I was talking with someone, and this person was dealing with a lot of guilt in their life, because they felt like that they had to be good enough to be saved. And I sat there and I listened. And I said to this person, nobody is good enough to be saved. And the person raised their eyebrows, never heard that before, and said, you mean we're not saved by being good? And I said, no, we can't be good enough to be saved. We're saved by being poor in spirit. We're saved by humbling ourselves and letting God know that we can't do it, which he already knows, but he's waiting on us to tell him, and that we need Jesus to be our Savior. And that day, I asked that person, I said, would you like to do that right now? And the person said, yes, I would. I really would. And I had the joy of sitting there and watching that person pray and invite Jesus to forgive their sins and invite Jesus to be their Savior. And immediately, the countenance of that person changed. And after they prayed and looked up, you could see the difference. I'm telling you, Jesus makes a difference in our life. He really does. And I said to this person, I said, now that you've accepted Jesus, what do you have to say? And they said to me, it feels good knowing that I don't have to be good enough to be saved. You see, all that guilt was carried for years. There may be somebody here like that. You've been living for years, ridden by guilt. The devil's played with your mind and had you convinced that you'll never be saved because you can't be good enough to be saved. The good news is that's why Jesus died on the cross. He's good enough to save us. He paid the price for our sin. And if you will trust God this morning through Jesus Christ, He will save you. And as we stand together right now here in the auditorium and in the worship center, we stand together and we're going to sing. And we invite anyone here this morning who has not done so to place their trust and faith in Jesus Christ as Savior. We invite anyone here who is not united with this church, who has prayed about it and feels led by the Spirit of God to come, we invite you to come and do that. And the altar is open. I had a person ask me the other day, is it all right to come to the altar and pray? I said, anytime. It's always open. It's always here. And if you want to come and pray this morning, you come. Right now, as we sing, you come.